Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Poland Daily History. Today we are taking a closer look at a historical reenactment scene in Poland. We are here at a medieval fair organized by Fundacja Skrzydła Chwały, or the Wings of Glory Foundation. It is an enormous event where hundreds of people all across Poland converge to demonstrate the functionalities of the legendary Polish Winged Hussar cavalry.
First, we will ask the historian Dr. Krzysztof Jabłonka about the origins of the Polish Hussars and why they transformed from light cavalry units into the heavy cavalry formation, which was immortalized by its victory in the Battle of Vienna against the Ottoman Empire in 1683.
Początki husarii należy upatrywać w walkach granicznych Królestwa Węgierskiego z naporem Turków.
The beginning of the story of the Polish Hussars are to be found in the battles for the borders of the Hungarian military against the surge of Turks. Here it must be noted that our Hungarian brothers were inspired by Persians, since the Hussars looked more Oriental than Central European. Through both their picturesque wings and other parts of their outfit, like their sabers, etc. The Kingdom of Hungary got demolished in 1526 in a tragic battle of Mohacs, where our king's nephew, Louis II of Hungary, died, beginning an era of partitions. This is when, firstly, volunteer and later regular units of so-called harcownicy, or hussar, were established on the borderlands shared with the Turks. Thousands of Serbians, who were then called hajduks or eunuchs, ran away and organized into units that aimed to push away the Turks. When Stefan Batory, the Prince of Transylvania, was elected King of Poland, a procession of the Hussars traveled along with them. The soldiers presented themselves very well, with the beautiful feathered wings attached to their saddles. There are multiple legends revolving around the Hussar wings, however most of them are false. One such false premise is an explanation which can currently be described as historical, saying that they were used to catch the wind. The wings of an eagle or a hawk later attached to the armor were supposed to indicate the direction of the wind. The Hussars would always organize their units in accordance with the wind and would always attack with the wind direction. That was because their units were scarce. They would usually be in formation with just one row, sometimes with the second right behind, but that was it. The wind was supposed to mask that fact, since the horses would blow up clouds of dirt and sand with their run. Out of those clouds of dirt, the Hussars would emerge. It created enormous pressure and instilled fear in the opponents. It was an incredible psychological advantage. Although it had a military purpose, it was mainly a psychological weapon. This first group of troops which came to Poland with Stefan Batory quickly organized a separate formation out of the Polish nobility. The new group was characterized by the wearing of leopard skin, which were bought on a Persian market. They were used in the Battle of Libiszowo, 1577, against the Free City of Gdańsk, which chose Maximilian Habsburg as their leader and did not want to subordinate to Stefan Batory. Obviously, the situation resolved itself as you could imagine. A small Polish unit demolished the entire infantry of the Free City of Gdańsk. Those Gdańsk citizens who supported Stefan Batory were victorious, and Gdańsk remained not just free, but a part of the Polish Republic. That was most important. Naturally, the city reaped the rewards of being a part of the Republic. Separating itself would have been a disaster. Nevertheless, the Hussars as a formation were clothed in Persian outfits, which quickly became our own national attire. Juban was a piece of attire taken directly from the Persian nobility. In the 17th century, someone even wrote about a representative of Persian nobility saying, "He talks in a language similar to Polish," which means either we came from them or they came from us. The battles with Moscow and with Sweden at the same time brought with itself booming development of this formation. They grew as large as a couple thousand. The units created a formation referred to as the deciding blow. This is when the Hussars would put on their armors and helmets, which would often be embellished with feathers too. At that point, the Hussars became an armored division. There were three crucial events when the help of the Hussars were used. These were the Battle of Kirchholm, 22nd of September 1605. The historical records state that the Hussars positioned themselves with the wind. As they were attacking from the Daugava River, the Swedes had to reposition themselves by 90 degrees. This attack was based on the direction of the wind. The Hussars would get into position very quickly due to the fact that their horses would react in the same way. If the general's horse would alter its position, all the other horses followed suit. The adversaries never knew how many Hussars were attacking, and so the first rows of Swedes got demolished. In the Battle of Kirchholm, the Hussars attacked 7 or 8 times, battling off the Swedish and Moscow forces. However, it was the Battle of Vienna that brought the most pride and fame to the Hussars. This was the biggest change of the 17th century. The cavalry led by Jan Sobieski III counted as many as 30 to 40,000. Combined with an almost equal number of Turkish horsemen, a frontal attack commenced, in which the army of Turks was simply obliterated.
At the medieval fair, we will talk with a member of a historical reenactment group about the history of the Cossacks. These troops were at times allied with the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, while at other times fought against it in bloody rebellions.
First of all, for the audience at home, can you tell us what attire are you wearing today? Which side of the militia do you represent? What is this costume? Who are you wearing?
The costume that I'm wearing, the unit in what I'm part, mm-hmm. that's a unit of Cossacks. But not Zaporozhian Cossacks.
No?
There was called Cossacks Rejestrowy, okay. Because we were recruited from the militia that was Cossacks Zaporozhian Cossacks, mm-hmm. and we were on pay by the Polish king, not nobles, but by the Polish king. Mm-hmm. Yes, and we were paid in gold. And in the fabric to mm-hmm. make clothes.
Sure. And can you tell us a little bit about this faction, the Cossacks? What are their significance in the reenactment?
Yes, because where was the Polish army, mm-hmm. there was Cossacks. Sometimes little numbers, sometimes very big numbers.
Sure.
Because they were very good soldiers.
Right.
Because they were fighting from kids' age.
Mm-hmm.
They lived from fighting. They was like mercenaries, and mm-hmm. they was like fighters. They robbed. They lived from mm-hmm. robbing the Ottoman Empire.
Oh, sure. So they would like harden in battle,
yes.
pretty much. And so you would say they were very close to the army of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth at the time.
Yes, we in reenactment society, we mm-hmm. say that there was four mm-hmm. very elite infantry forces.
Okay.
There was the Hispanic Tercio,
mm-hmm.
the Swedish soldiers after the military reforms,
mm-hmm.
The Polish Haiduks, the Polish infantry with arquebuses,
mm-hmm.
and the Cossacks.
As we have seen today, there were plenty of challenges and adversaries facing the Polish-Lithuanian army in the 17th century.
But with enough preparation, superior tactics and armory, the legendary Polish Winged Hussars were able to secure plenty of victories in pivotal battles, ones such as the Battle of Kirchholm, Klushino, and most importantly and famously, the Battle of Vienna. That's it for today. I'm your host, Benjamin Lee, and I'll see you next time on Poland Daily History.